Hi everyone, I'm Marco and today we're going to see how to create an awesome Rust project on GitHub. So, first warning, we will see no Rust code today, but we will see what normally surrounds it in a repository, such as GitHub Actions, so continuous integrations, continuous delivery and security checks, and documentation. With documentation I don't mean the library documentation, for example, code comments, this kind of stuff, but just the files that GitHub really tell you to include, for example, contributing guidelines, the README, the license, and so on, all these kind of markdown files. So we have a problem, and this problem is we sort of finished the project, or maybe we have a prototype, we want to update our project on GitHub, right? So we have two alternatives in order to do so, because we need all this, the previous stuff, so GitHub Actions and documentation, right, in order to do a nice project. We can copy paste this stuff from bigger projects, but this is really boring, it's not that funny. Or maybe, yeah, since we don't want to do it, we publish the project as it is. So we don't provide the README, basically it means that a visitor of your project doesn't know what the project does. And this is not really professional, it's not acceptable for a nice project, right? So the solution is to use the Rust GitHub template that I created. So it is a cargo generate template, but let's see the GitHub organization. So this is the GitHub organization, and there are two pinned repositories. The template itself and an example that has been created starting from this template. Then we have an example synchronizer that has the only job of automatically updating the example whenever the template is updated. And then we have a nice website that tells you, it's not really nice, it's really ugly, but it tells you to install how to create a new project starting from this template. Okay, so first of all, yeah, basically it automatically creates boring stuff for us, so GitHub Actions and documentation, as we said before. Okay, so the agenda for today is that first we analyze the example, then we see how the template is done internally. In this way, if you understand it, you can create your own cargo generate template. And then we see how to create a project from zero, starting from this template. This is really the easiest part, it's really easy with cargo generate. Okay, so first, so let's see the example in order to see how a Rust GitHub project should look like, in my opinion. So let's start from the bottom and let's go up. First we have the README, so yeah, just the title of the example, and then some pages. The first one goes to crazy.io, where people search for Rust projects normally. Then we have the documentation to the docs. This is just an example, so the docs is really minimal. Then we have an indication that tells you that the continuous integration is working. So if you click here, you go to the actions panel here, and you can see the status of the GitHub actions. And then we have Rust code coverage, which is obtained with the cargo tarpaulin, and it uses coveralls.io, so you have to register to this website. But the nice thing is that it tells you for every file how much of this file is tested. For example, if you click here on main.rs, it says that the main is not tested, as you can expect. So then I included some installation instructions on the always in the README. Normally you install a Rust project by doing a cargo install and then the name of the project under the crates.io website. Then there is the license, and for the license I didn't invent a lot. If you go to the Rust GitHub API guidelines, here you can see that they suggest you to use MIT or Apache, and this is what I just copy-pasted in the template, so we are on the same line with all the other Rust projects. Okay, so then yeah, we have the license and the two license files. And yeah, you can see that the license is filled with your username and the GitHub email. Then we have the cargo toml. I just added some stuff to with respect to the template. So for example, yeah, the name for sure, the version I edited it, the authors is filled by cargo template, so it is automatic. The edition of course is automatic. Yeah, I added just the description and the home page, I think. The other is automatically generated by the template. So basically the repository is a link to the GitHub project, the license as we saw, and the README tells crates.io to visualize this file as the README. So if you go to the crates.io page, you see the README that is specified in the source code in the repository. Well, okay, we have contributing guidelines and code of conduct. So let's see first code of conduct, just a simple line to tell that this project adheres to the Rust code of conduct, and I just included a link to the official website, nothing fancy. Then we have contributing guidelines. First off, we thank anyone who is willing to contribute to give his contribution to our project. Here the name is filled automatically. I just suggest to create a new issue before making a big pull request, so we can discuss about it. I just invite people to search for an issue before submitting it, because it may be duplicated, and then just try to do one pull request per change. Then, as you can see, I included some advice on how to update the changelog. So the next file, in fact, is the changelog itself, which follows the conventions by keep a changelog. So keep a changelog is a convention that is normally used for keeping changelogs, and I just summarized all the main parts here in the contributing sections. So basically you have, for each change you make, you have to update the related section under the unreleased section of the changelog. So for example here, this is the unreleased section, so you have to write here basically under this section. So for example, if you add a new feature, you should write to the added subsection. So we can see here there is an example on their website. For example, here there is the added subsection with all the changes. Here there is the changed subsection, which is when you change an existing functionality. So I don't know, if you fix some bugs, it should be under the fixed subsection, and so on. Just if the subsection does not yet exist, just create it. And whenever the maintainer decides to do a new version, it just adds this line. It says the version and when it was released, and so here new changes can be applied to the unreleased section. It's really easy. Okay, so then this part is for new guys, basically, because it's something that Rust developers knows, but I think it might be nice to include it. So this is how to you build the project, you clone the repo, you cd into your directory, and you cargo build, of course. And then you can build the release version and the cargo run with the release version. This is because a lot of new people, they do benchmarks or they just run the application without the release flag, and so they say, oh, it's not that fast. No, you should run with the release flag if you are measuring the speed of your program. So some advices: you can run the Clippy linter with this command, you can run all tests with this command, you can see if the code is formatted with this command, and you can format the code with this command. You should do these three commands by themselves before submitting the pull request, because the CI will detect these errors, so the CI will fail. So if you can fix this before the PR is nice, I mean, but otherwise the PR just fails. Okay, so we have the gitignore, which is just the default one of Cargonio. Then we have the source, and the source, I added something with respect to the template, because the template is just a main file, what Cargonio tells you, what Cargonio generates for you. But here I just added something in order to trigger the tests. So I just added a bunch of stupid stuff in order to say, okay, this is covered, this test passes, something like that. Well, okay, we have the .github subfolder, which is the biggest one, the most difficult one, let's say, but we will do it. So this is the pull request. Okay, let's start with the issue templates. Okay, we are in the issues section. So if you open a new issue, it will ask if you want to report a bug, if you want a feature request, or if you want to open a blank issue. So the blank issues is enabled by this config.yaml file. I just put blank issues enabled to true. Why not? Then we can see the bug report. Let's see the row. Okay, the name matches with this bug report. Then this is the about, it matches with this description. And then we can click to get started. So here you can see that the label bug is automatically assigned. And the content of this markdown file is placed here in the issue description. So this is what a new user will see when they open a new issue. All these comments you see are not visualized when you post the repo, the issue. But they will tell the user what to do. So for example, here I say to the user, just put a clear and concise description of what the bug is, place a reproducing guide of of how to reproduce this issue with all the steps, tell me what is the expected behavior, and for example, if you are gentle and if it is applicable, you can add screenshots, and you can describe your environment. This for sure has to be edited with the information relevant to your own project, and some additional context, why not. So this is the bug report. Of course, the user can press to submit new issue when they are done. And there is also the feature request, but it's the same concept. So I show you here there is the feature request. Let's see the raw stuff. Okay, so just describe what the problem is, what the solution you'd like, the alternatives you've considered, and some additional context, yeah, screenshots, something like that. I, my opinion, if people see this template, they will give more organized info, more detailed info, and it may be good for our project. So these were the issue templates. Now we can see the pull request template, but it's really simple. It's just a bunch of comments that the user will see when they submit the pull request. So just please be sure you have read the contributing guidelines that we saw before. Please check if you have formatted the code, if the test passes, and so on. So they avoid bad surprises when they submit the pull request. So here we have the workflows, which are the GitHub actions. So for example, let's start with the CI, continuous integration. Basically, continuous integration are some checks that in this case GitHub does whenever there is a push to the code or a pull request. So what are the jobs that GitHub has to do? First, we do the test. So this job is named the test suite. It runs on Ubuntu latest, and these are all the steps that this job has to do. So first we want to check out the repository. When you see uses, it means that we are using a GitHub action from other guys. In this case, we are using the GitHub actions from the actions, which are, I think, the official GitHub actions. Let's say. But here we are using the actions from ActionRS, which is a GitHub organization that collects a lot of useful Rust-related GitHub actions. So they have the cargo action, which it allows you to execute run cargo commands, the audit check that is used for security audits that we will see. It has also the tarpaulin, which it does code coverage that we will see, and so on. So after we check out our repository, we want to install the Rust toolchain. We want the stable version of it. You can also use Nightly if this is what you use. And then we want to run the command cargo test. Okay, so if the tests are okay, this job passes. Otherwise, it fails, and so the PR is not. GitHub tells the user that this PR is not valid and they should fix it. Without your intervention. RustFMT just checks if the code is correctly formatted. So this is the same as before. So we want to check out our repository and we want to install the Rust toolchain, but we want to install RustFMT together with our toolchain. So we can tell cargo to run cargo FMT, and with these arguments that they just tell return error if the code is not formatted. Same thing with Clippy. So we specify to our toolchain that we want to use Clippy, and we just tell cargo to run this project, that to this command, cargo Clippy with these arguments, and this whole job fails if Clippy has at least one warning. Last thing is the code coverage. I covered the code coverage in a previous video, in two previous videos, so check out them. We used the cargo tarpaulin. We are using cargo tarpaulin, which I covered in those videos, so you should be an expert already. So with this action, which is action RS tarpaulin, we are running our cargo tarpaulin with this argument. So we are, if you remember, we are generating an ELCOV file on the current directory. So this is the path to the ELCOV file, and we are passing this path to the next step, which is upload to coveralls. So we are using the GitHub action from the coveralls app repo, and every time there is a push, we want to update the code, the coverage on the coveralls website. Why I specified that it should be on push? Because otherwise, every time a guy does a pull request, it updates the coveralls website, which we want to update only whenever a change is accepted into our code base. So after that, we have we can take a look at the audit action, so security audit, which is from action RS again. And this action is triggered every day or whenever there is a push on one of those paths. Because what is that this extension with this action does? It just checks if there are some known vulnerabilities on all your dependencies. And as you know, the dependencies are specified in the cargo.toml and cargo.lock files. Here, I think that it runs on every pull request, but maybe I should specify paths also here, let me know. Okay. We have the last one, which is the most difficult one, but we will do it, the continuous deployment. So, of course, you don't want to deploy your app at every commit, I think. You want to do, maybe, is to deploy your app, and with deploy I mean generate the executable and update the app on crates.io. You want to do this stuff whenever you do a git tag. So when you do something like git tag minus a 0.1.5, right? Whenever you do this and you push this tag, this is triggered. Because it matches this regular expression. So this is saying whenever there is a number dot another number dot another number. Okay, so this is when this action is triggered. But what this action does? So we want to run this action for Mac, macOS, Ubuntu, and Windows. So in order to do this, we specify a matrix. So we say that we want to repeat this action for all these configurations, okay? And here we specify some properties of these configurations. So for example, we say that for macOS, we want this target and this prefix. We will use the prefix later. And for example, for Windows, we say that we want the binary postfix.exe. For Linux, we want this target. And I mean, I just this target, you can find them not here. So Rustlang tier list platform support. Here there are all the targets of Rustlang. For example, we want Windows 64-bit, and this is what we included. We want Linux 4-bit, which is this one, and here it is, and so on. Okay, these are the configurations. I just placed Rust in a the stable in a variable, because for example if later you want to change this to nightly, you can just edit this. Anyway, all the on the Rust GitHub website you can find the credits webpage, where there are all the credits, all the places where I copy pasted the stuff. So for example this CD is copied from Spotify UI. Okay, so so the steps of this action are the following. First you install the toolchain, the stable one, as specified in the variable. Then you want to check out the repository, then you build the project with the release flag, and for the target, their target specified in the matrix. So for example, if we are running the macOS latest configuration, this will match this, okay? So this is substituted here. Okay, then we want to package the final binary. So the binary will be placed in this directory, target slash x86, stuff like that, slash release. We want to cd in this directory, we want to remove all the debug symbols, which are they increase the binary size, and we just create a tar. So we compress this binary and we create this file. After that, if we create the a checksum, so this is the final result. You go to the homepage of just samples, and then for example we click on releases. As you can see, for every release, for example, Rust GitHub example Linux, it has the checksum and the decompressed archive that contains your binary. And this is for all the configuration of the matrix. And yeah, basically this creates the binary. Here you, with the tar, you compress it, and here you create the checksum. After that, this is just used to place these files in the every time when you do the release. So when you do the git tag command. Okay, so this, we placed the binary on GitHub, but we want also to update our project in cargo. So what you have to do is install the toolchain as always, and then you do cargo publish minus dash dash token, and here you have to specify the key to your personal key to crates.io. You don't have to share this key with anyone, but you can safely save this key in your repository. Because if you go to settings and secrets, you can see that I just set up my own cargo key. So you just click here on new repository secret, you specify this name, and here you place the value of the repository that you can copy paste from the cargo website. And so this is all the CD. So yes, we reviewed all the example. Next thing we want to do is to analyze the template. Now we go to from our browser. This is the GitHub organization. Okay. So the template is really similar to the example, of course, but there are some placeholders. These placeholders are, for example, the project name and other stuff. You can see them all from the cargo.toml file. So here you can see that the project name is substituted with the project name you specify to cargo generate. We will see this later. The authors are the authors of the crate. This is automatically filled by cargo new. Anyway, okay, the description just tells you that it's mandatory if you want to place it on crest.io. And this username and this is the username from your this is your GitHub username. Your Git username, I think. Anyway, this should match with the owner of the repository. So, for example, in this case, it should be Rust GitHub. But for example, if it was my private account, this should be my name. Okay, my nickname. Okay, so for the markdown files, this is really easy. For example, contributing, you see that I just placed the project name and it's automatically replaced with the actual project name. But the tricky part comes with the workflows. So it's not really important that you understand this, but it's just if you want to contribute to this template. If you have good ideas, you want to edit something, just submit an issue or a pull request, we can discuss about it. My goal is that this template becomes something that all the Rust developers look at when they want to place continuous integration in their project, place some markdown documentation files and so on. So we can build this together if you have some ideas. Okay, so the problem with the GitHub Actions is that they collide with the syntax of cargo generate, because as you saw cargo generate uses this syntax here, which comes from Liquid. This is their website. If you go to here, you can see all the syntax for that is supported by cargo generate. For example, if you go to row, they will tell you that if you place these row tags, the end result is that this is not replaced, okay? So this is the trick I used in order to place the GitHub actions. So basically, this GitHub token is not replaced by cargo generate because there are these row tags. Things are a little bit complex when you want to mix the cargo generate stuff, so for example project name, with the GitHub action stuff, so for example here in the CD file. And in order to do it, you just have this strange syntax for the GitHub variables, let's say. I know it's ugly, but this is how it is. Again, this is not relevant to you if you just want to use the template. Okay, so this is more or less how you create a template with the cargo generate. We can take a look at the repository. This is what we are going to do next. We are going to create a project, but here it tells you all the placeholders that are supported at the moment by cargo generate. So for example, the authors, the project name, the crate name, because if you specify a project with the minus with the dash character, in order to use it in Rust, you have to replace the dash with the underscore. and I don't know, the operating system. There are other templates such as for embedded, for WebAssembly, so you can also take a look at all the other templates by Cargo Generate. They are listed here in this file, the templates file. Okay, so this is the last thing we want to do. We want to create a new project. So maybe this is the first thing that I had to show you. Okay, in order to create a new Rust project, starting from this example, you can just follow the instructions on the Rust GitHub template website. So this is what I told you. First thing, instructions, right? First thing, you want to install Cargo Generate. I already have it. Then you want to say Cargo Generate build the project starting from this GitHub repo, which is the template repo that we saw before. So just copy paste and it tells us project name. Let's say, see that we are really stupid and we place some strange characters here. No, this is not a valid create name. Okay, so Rust EX, for example, I don't know. Okay, we created a project, so you can just cd into this project. And as you can see, all the stuff is here, so everything we say we saw before, the issue templates, Cargo TOML and so on. Everything is already there. There is only one problem. There is one step that you have to do until this PR is merged in the Cargo Generate repo, which is you have to replace all the occurrences of the username placeholder. For example, if you go to Cargo TOML file, we can see that here the username is not, it was not replaced by Cargo, by Cargo Generate. Instead, all the other placeholders were were replaced, right? We have the Rust EX name here and so on. So, in order to, but it's really easy because we can manually change all the occurrences of this in our project. In order to do it, if you're using Linux, you can just copy paste this, or if you're using I don't know, there are SD and FD that are common for also that works on also on Windows, so you can use them if you want. I'm on Unix, I will use sed and find, which are a little bit uglier, but I don't know, they come pre-installed, so here you want to change my username. Here, of course, you don't want to place my username, you want to place your GitHub handle, okay? So for example, here, if I want to put this example in under my name, so under my repositories, I can just say, instead of my username, I say Marco Ieni. Okay, let's see how it is now, and you can see that here this occurrence has been replaced, but you will see that it will be replaced on all the other occurrences. And okay, next step, of course, this is just a template. You have to edit it in order to meet your own needs. And then you can create a new empty repository on GitHub, and you can push this project to GitHub. After that, you want to set up the GitHub secret of creates.io, as I showed before in the settings, And then you want to, if you want code coverage from Coveralls, you have to sign up to their website and you have to add this repo. Okay, whenever you want to do a release, so whenever you want to trigger the continuous deployment, you just type git tag, you just set the version of that you want to publish, and then git push follow tags. And so, as we said, with the continuous deployment, your application will be published to crates.io, and the binaries will be placed on GitHub releases. Thank you for watching. I think that that's it. Where is the presentation? Here. These are my contacts. This is my website, my YouTube channel, Twitter, GitHub, LinkedIn. Yeah, if you like this project, you can we can discuss about things, you can open issues. I mean, it's I want this to be a community effort. So thank you very much. If you like Rust, subscribe, because I will do a lot of contents, and that's it. Bye.